everyone, and welcome back to the vlog. As always, a massive thank you for tuning in and following this journey and for taking the time out to come and sit and watch these vlogs. So thank you so much to everyone. And today's vlog is all about the dreaded OSCE. So where I studied at Birmingham City University, we had one OSCE in our first year. I was very fortunate. So I can give you all of the tips and advice I can about OSCEs and what we did at Birmingham City University, but your university and wherever you are might do something slightly different. But hopefully I'm going to give you some good tips to help you cope in your OSCE as well as just doing a run through. So our OSCE came in two parts. The first part was a 20-minute anatomy and physiology exam. And I think it was about 10 questions, I think it was. It was probably about 3 years ago now that we did that, so my memory is not there. But I think it was about 10 questions, and we had four papers that we could get given, and we didn't know which we would be given on the day, so we had to revise all of it basically. But the choice was the skin, and then I think we had respiratory, cardiology, and the renal system, I think, were the four that we had. I was very fortunate to get skin because it was, I'm not gonna lie, the easiest exam out of all of them. So I was very fortunate that I got the easier, well, the exam that I found the easiest was the skin over all the other ones. So I was very fortunate that I got that one. I'm not saying it was the easier exam, but it's just the one that I found the easiest. Personal judgment. Someone else might have found respiratory a lot easier, someone else might have found cardiology or renal a lot easier, but skin was my thing back then at the very first starting off, so I was chuffed when I opened that paper. And in that exam we had to label some diagrams, so we had the little diagram of the epidermis, dermis, and we had to label it all. It was all blank, and then we just had some simple sort of questions like the functions of the skin, things like that. Explain a little bit about hemostasis, things like that. There was nothing really too tricky, I think, in that exam, so I was very fortunate that I passed. The second part of the OSCE was the actual physical OSCE. So for R1, we had to do a set of observations on a patient. The patient was your examiner, and you had a second examiner in the corner with the little clipboard marking you. So I had to go in, I had to pretend I was on placement, for example, I was out there on a ward, and I would go in and I would do the blood pressure, the temperature, the pulse check, and the respiratory rate on my patient, making sure they're comfortable, making sure I explain all of the ranges as well of each and what I would do if these were out or abnormal. And luckily I managed to just set my mind to, right, this is a real life situation rather than an exam. And I actually was quite calm throughout my OSCE because I don't know how I did it. Don't ask me how, but I managed to just put myself in that place. I'm on a ward, this is my patient, and I'm gonna be professional, and this is what I'm gonna do. And it just, I don't know how, but it worked. So if you can get yourself into that frame of mind, don't think of it as an exam. That is the biggest tip I can give you. You do this already. You've probably had a placement already. If you haven't had a placement, you've never done all the observations and things like that, then just practice that routine, and you will be absolutely perfect. And that was pretty much it for our OSCE. That's all we had. I know some people do like a speaking exam, so you'll have the examiner asking you questions and you've got to respond and talk through the processes of the body, things like that, anatomy and physiology stuff. Luckily we didn't have that, thank God. But it, and again, it depends which field of nursing you're in, because they all do something different as well. I know my friend who was a mental health student nurse, and they got what they call a visor or something like that. And that was a very spoken exam. You would go in and they would quiz you on a load of mental health capacity acts and things like that. So very different to what I did as a student. So it's really important to know what you're gonna be doing, where you're at. But at Birmingham City University, ours was, it was pretty straightforward. It wasn't too hard at all. It was just, people were just getting nervous because they knew it was an exam more than anything. Lastly, on a last little note, I'm going to do a very quick, brief run through of how I did my OSCE, exactly step for step, and what I did so that you know what I did that might help you out. Step one. I walked into the room and I said, hello, my name is Claire. I am a student nurse here. Do you mind if I do your observations, which includes blood pressure, pulse check, temperature, and respiratory rate check? Is that okay with you? Yes. One, I've introduced myself. 2, I've explained the procedure and what I'm going to do step by step to them. 3, I've gained that verbal consent. Next on the list, you're going to say, okay, Mr. Let's just say Kevin Smith. Hello, Kevin Smith. Do you have a preferred name that you'd like to be called? And they will say, yes, actually, just call me Kevin. I say, thank you. That's perfect. And then you've then gained your next step, which is getting your patient's preferred name. Next, you want to do your first bit of observation. So for me, I always did the blood pressure first. I don't know why, but it was just my go-to thing. So I explained that to the patient. I got all my equipment. I clean all the equipment down so I know it's cleaned and it's there. Infection control is your next hit on the thing. So then I would say to the patient, okay, I'm going to do your manual blood pressure now. I would do the manual blood pressure. And then I would give the readings and I would say, okay, your blood pressure today is 130 over 70. And that is the perfect range because your systolic should be between 100 and 140 and your diastolic should be anywhere between 60 and 90. So this is in the perfect range. And then if you've got a good examiner, they will respond to you. They'll be very nice. But oh, okay, thank you for that information. That's great, Claire. Let's get on with the next bit. And yeah, so then I would go and I would check the pulse. Whilst I'm checking the pulse, say to the patient, okay, Kevin, I'm now just going to go and check your pulse. Is that okay with you? Yep, thank you. And I say to them, I'm going to check it for 2 minutes if that's okay with you. And they'll say, yep, fantastic. So then I will check the pulse for 1 minute and I'll measure the pulse. And then for the second minute, I will count the respiratory rate. And we do that because you don't want to tell the patient that you're counting the respiratory rate because they will breathe irregularly and they'll be like this because they're focusing on their breathing because they're thinking that you're watching their breathing, if that makes sense. So we were always taught, tell them you're going to check their pulse for 2 minutes. First minute you do the pulse, second minute you do the respiratory rate. And then once you have done that, so I explain to my patient, I say, I'm really sorry, I know that took 2 minutes, but actually I had to do the respiratory rate on top of your pulse rate, because if I explained to you that I was going to do your respiratory rate, it might affect the reading. So we tell you that we're going to do the pulse rate, but actually I did the pulse and then the respiratory rate afterwards. I hope that's okay. And then the patient will say, yes, that's fine. Beautiful. Thank you. And then I will say, okay, that's great. So your pulse rate was 78 and that's perfect because it's in the normal range of between 60 and 100. That's the average range that we look for. Yours is 78, so that's great. And your respiratory rate was 14 today. So that's great because the ranges for respiratory rate is between 12 and 20 per minute. So that's a great range for you as well. So then I will do the temperature. I will make sure I clean it all off. I've put a fresh clean cover on it. I would tell the patient what you're going to do. Okay, I'm going to do temperature now. And then I would pull back the ear. Make sure there's no hearing aids in the ear. Ask the patient, do they wear hearing aids? No, that's fine. Let's go. Pull the ear back. Put the thermometer in. Press the button. Check it out. Okay, yep, your temperature is 37. That is perfect because the average range is 36.5 to 37.5. Fantastic. And then I just end it with, okay, I've now finished all of your observations. They are all in range. However, if any one of these were out of range, then I would have to report it back to my mentor and just get them to look into this a bit further. Is that okay? And do you need anything else from me? Can I get you anything else? Patient will say, no, that's fine. Thank you. And off you go. And just on a final little bit, always make sure that you've documented everything on your News 2 chart correctly. That's the last thing that we were assessed on as well, was they go through your News chart and make sure you've put those ranges in there. They're all in range. You've put everything in the right boxes. You haven't got anything wrong, and job done. So my top tips for surviving your OSCE: know what you're doing for a start. Make sure you're practicing. Practice with your family, your friends. COVID safe, of course, we are in a pandemic, but just keep practicing. Practice on your dogs, your cats, whatever. But just do, if the more you run through it every single day or every month or every 2 weeks leading up to your exam, however you want to do it, the more you practice, the more comfortable and confident you will feel. And this is exactly what I did. I literally just practiced whenever I could. I made sure my manual blood pressure was on point. So just, I knew that I was going to be confident on the day because I practiced it so much. I had nothing to do. I was just there and I was like, yeah, okay, here we go. And it really does make a big difference the more you practice, honestly, guys. And next, like I said, just make sure you try and think of it like a real life situation. I know it's almost impossible because it's not a real life situation. It is an exam room and they're not your patients, but you have to really set your mind on, right, this is what I do on placement. I'm going to treat this as a placement and just get through it that way. Because if you can set your mind like that, honestly, it really helps the nerves and you just fly through it and you're just like, yeah, okay, it's done. And then you worry about it afterwards. It's honestly, it's the best thing that I managed to do. And I still have no idea how I did it. So if you really suffer with anxiety around exams and things like that, find your way of relaxing and calming yourself before you go into that exam. So some things like breathing techniques are really, really good and helpful. I saw this one on TikTok actually, where someone said that if you get really, really anxious, if you hold a bottle of water and throw that bottle of water from side to side, let me find something. It's not a bottle of water, but if you do this, and you just concentrate on that, apparently that process of doing that really helps calm your mind and relieve that anxiety. And it's because of the imbalance in the mind of the two different sides. So if you're doing that, it helps to balance it out. I don't know if this works. I have not tried this yet, but you know what? It's free and easy. So if it works, amazing. One thing I did use though, I used to do a lot of meditation actually, because I found that this just really helped me settle, as well as the breathing techniques. And I also used pulse point rollers, which I still have. So I have these ones, Mind Clear. There's another one for stress that I've got on the side as well, stress and anxiety specifically. Also lavender oil on your pulse points. Just put it here. You might smell like lavender for the rest of the day, but it does help me, or it helps me anyway. Hopefully it'll help you too. And there is some research behind it as well, so it is good. But it just helps to just have that sense of calm feeling. And I used to use them actually a lot when I went to the dentist, because I hate the dentist and I get so anxious. So that is one place I do use them, as well as exams and assessments. It just works for me. It might not for you, but it's about finding what works for you and doing more of that. So whatever helps you to calm those nerves and release that anxiety, do more of that. And lastly, OSCEs are also more about you and the way you present and your communication skills as well with that patient. It's how you are as a student nurse and going out into the placement area. So if you can try and be as professional as possible, make sure your uniform's clean, hair's up, no earrings, nothing like that, look the part. Because I know for ours, we got mocked down for uniforms and things like body language and communication. So just make sure you've got those perfected before you go into that room as well. If you're nervous, then you're nervous. Don't worry about it. They're going to expect nerves. But just make sure that you look the part and you come across as a little bit more confident than you might feel. And also, it's about being safe as well. So if you find a situation where, if you're doing a set of obs like I had to do, for example, and you literally cannot hear the pulse for the blood pressure, you can't hear anything, you're really struggling, that's okay, because sometimes you just can't. Sometimes you do get that with patients and it's just impossible and you have to get someone else to do it. So as long as you just stop and say and be open and honest with the examiners and just say, I'm really, really sorry, I'm not getting anything here, I can't hear anything, and then explain what you would do in that situation out on placement to show that you're safe and competent at doing that, that's okay. So as long as you say something along the lines, I'm really sorry, I can't get this pulse right now, I don't know what's happened, I've tried both arms, I can't hear anything, I can't feel anything. If this was me out in placement, then I would go and get another nurse or my mentor to come and check it out for me. Then that's it. They just want to show that you have got things in place for when things aren't quite right or things are going wrong, that you are safe and competent at doing that as well. So it's all about best practice and looking after your patient at the end of the day. And these things happen, like I said, so don't worry about it. Don't stress about it. Don't get so overwhelmed and have a breakdown about it, because it's okay and that's perfectly fine to do that. So for the anatomy and physiology section, I have done a whole vlog about revision techniques and how to help you remember for the exam. So I'm going to put the link below. Go and have a look at that if you haven't already. That'll really hopefully help you when you're trying to revise these things for your OSCEs as well. It can be really useful. I know that all these tips helped me, so I'm hoping, fingers crossed, they help you. But again, it's about you as an individual and how you learn and how you remember stuff. That's the best way for you. Me telling you anything like do this or do that, it might not work for you. So it's about finding out about yourself and what helps you remember at the end of the day and do more of that. So I hope that was really, really helpful for you. I hope that you've got something out of that, just a little talk through of the OSCE and what happens. That's literally how I did mine. You just think of it step by step, make sure you're gaining consent, introducing yourself, health and safety, infection control, everything's going to go perfect. Don't sweat it. And on that note, I'm going to say goodbye, everyone, and I shall see you next time. Have an amazing Christmas. It's Christmas next week, guys. I hope that you're all going to stay safe and hope you can have some sort of enjoyment over Christmas with the lockdown restrictions and everything. But for now, it's a goodbye from me, and I shall see you all next time.